Hi, I'm Larry Micronda. Welcome to this edition of Socioforum Profiles. And with us via remote is Dr. Sanjay Godwhani, continuing our series with him. He's going to answer some of the questions that we have about both the COVID and some of the other things that are going on in the medical community. Thank you, Dr. Godwhani, for being with us via remote. We do appreciate it. Dr. Godwhani, is there any update you can give us on this, on the COVID-19 right now?
Thank you. over time, it can build up into deposits on my BI, and it can lead to more serious issues. I've never seen anybody go blind from this medication, but that is one of the side effects. And the people that do get the vision loss is one of the long-term side effects are the ones that are not going to the eye doctor. So any patient that I'm seeing, too. We can lower blood sugars. So if you're a diabetic and you're on this medication, you may be able to lower one of your diabetic medications. It can also help reduce cholesterol. You can get some weight loss with the medication. And in some cases, it's also used to treat and prevent blood clots. So it has a lot of good benefits. And I know there's a lot of controversy out there about just to let you guys know what the drug is and how it works, and also some of the common side effects versus the long-term side effects. So another thing about Plaquenil, we talked about the side effects, but the heart issue that a lot of patients call me about, what's this heart issue? It's called acute coronation. So the heart has a little beat to it, and it indicates it can extend that beat out and cause the rhythm of irregular heartbeat. We don't see it commonly, you know, but there are interactions with other medications that make that possible. Other medications like antibiotics, ciprofloxacin, levoquin, some common drugs. Some antidepressants can interact with Plaquenil, and other cardiac medications can interact. So it's important with our EMR to check if there's a risk, but always talking to the pharmacist if there's interaction. And then, of course,
now, one of the questions that we got from a viewer was, how could we tell if it's COVID-19 or Lyme disease if you're having some of these symptoms?
Here's the key, guys, of a lot of things about tick disease and Lyme disease in particular. Lyme disease can be rash. It's this classic, but half the time we don't see it. And the reason we don't see it is it could be in the back of your head, it could be in your buttocks, it could be on your armpit, things that, places that you may not look normally. So it's important that if you're out hiking, kids are playing in the yard, to come and check fully before you notice these symptoms at home. But if they do get killed by these viruses and such, then it's important to get tested for both. If you're having respiratory symptoms, definitely test for coronavirus. But if you're not having a lot of respiratory symptoms, then maybe talk to your doctor and get tested for tick disease. And the last thing I want to mention about the Lyme disease, guys, is there are some serious things that can happen. Heart blocks. So we talked a lot about the heart today, but you can get swollen beats in the heart with Lyme disease. You can get Bell's palsy. You can get recurrent infections. It can even get into your brain and affect your spine before you get meningitis or encephalitis. So it's important to get tested immediately if you are experiencing flu-like symptoms, joint pains. In our country, in our environment, especially
thank you.
caused Lyme disease. There's babesiosis, anaplasmosis, ehrlichiosis, Rocky Mountain spotted fever. So when people get bit by a tick and then you come back and say that my doctor tested me for Lyme and it came back negative, but I'm still not feeling Lyme. I'm still getting body aches. I'm still getting some night sweats. My joints are hurting. My knee is swollen. So it's important to tell your provider to test for all tick-borne diseases and not just Lyme. And then other ticks that are out there, like the dog tick, the Morningstar tick, they all carry diseases too. And these things are tiny, they're like little pouchy seeds. And then you may not even know some stuff in your head. So it's important to check your kids, especially if you're out again, wearing long protective gear. Get bit prevention is the key to success. But the lower starts it. Regardless if it transmits the disease or not, it can cause what's known as a meat allergy, which is scary for a carnivore to eat. And you don't have to get a disease from it, but you may develop an intolerance to red meat and pork and things like that. So there are ways to test for that. If you all of a sudden start getting allergies to things that you commonly eat, it's called alpha gal. So there's a test that can detect this and tell you if you're at risk for tick disease or if you've got it. Right, so any kind of allergic reaction, so the most common would be itching, hives, maybe some diarrhea. Yes, in rare cases, you can get what's like a severe allergy. The lip and tongue would swell. Could get some difficulty breathing. So for those kinds of conditions, obviously, always seek immediate attention in urgent care in ER if you're having those severe type reactions. But for the most part, you may start noticing itching. So lately we've been seeing a lot of inflammatory bad news, and it's important to notice what these things are, and we'll talk about them coming up. But even with telemedicine, guys, it's important that you have tools and rules and techniques. Even U.S. patients out there should not let your health get affected. Maybe you can't go and physically see a doctor, get your medications, keep your appointments. Telemedicine is still very important. I've had a lot of patients initially cancel appointments. I'll see you next week, I'll see you next month. But this pandemic is lasting. It's still going on. So if you have something in your routine for it, you need attention, seek it. So over the last few months, I've seen a lot of inflammatory bad news. A lot of people say that you might be really good in the U.S. There's a difference between the types of arthritis, right? And inflammatory bad news is stiffness. It's stiffness, especially when you're born. You're unable to bed down, you're tying your shoes, you wake up in the middle of the night with pain. Stiff, very, very stiff. Now, like most arthritis, it's like back pain, which is like osteoarthritis, like degenerative disc disease. So that's wear and tear. And that wear and tear can affect your knees, your shoulder, your hands. But what happens with inflammatory back pain is it doesn't get better if you rest. And if you're sitting, you're not in a lot of pain, but once you start moving, you get that stiffness again. So it usually onsets at the age of 40 or less. So a lot of people have been suffering with back pain for almost a decade. They've seen pain management, they've been to the chiropractor, they've seen the physical therapist. They've been to so many doctors, got injections, procedures, but something just doesn't help. So something more is going to need. And by the time you're seeking attention from me as a rheumatologist for this condition, it's already been sleep now and then get up after an hour. You know, that was the coronavirus. A lot of people were working from home. You know, maybe their office, they were able to walk around and do things and they might not have noticed it. But now they're home on their computer or they're on their meetings. And then they get up from their meeting and they're like, wow, what is this doing? I'm like, why am I not even in bed? So I asked them questions like that. If you're sitting at home, what do you feel like? Right? Are you stiff? Those were some of the signs and symptoms of this as inflammatory back pain, which can lead to diseases and conditions on the nerves like spinal arthritis, that's arthritis of the spine, and it's an inflammatory condition. So spinal arthritis, in the term is arthritis of the spine, and this is inflammatory. Now, I like the fact that spinal arthritis is a category, and there's subsets within that category. So some of them can lead to psoriasis, like psoriatic arthritis can cause inflammatory back pain. It can cause pain in other joints too, guys. It's not just your back. You can have some stiffness in your hand, you can have some stiffness in your other joints, other conditions. And this is a major one, guys, and I really want you guys to pay attention to this. It's called this is a spinal arthropathy, inflammatory back pain, and a lot of young people in their 20s, early 30s, suffer from this. And they have that pain that I've been describing in the morning sickness. They can't get bed. I just saw a 26-year-old guy recently, and incidentally found a tan skin that kicked his stomach or something and went to the ER. And they did a CAT scan. SI joint, the sacroiliac joint, is the joint where your spine attaches to your pelvis. And it was fused already at the age of 26. And a lot of young people out there, if you have kids, teenagers, younger family members, siblings, they're describing this low back pain. Don't ignore it. I have seen some attention to get a massage for a week, but those are just temporary. Work with you guys to see a rheumatologist and assess and talk to them about this type of inflammatory back pain. Now, things like colitis, Crohn's disease, IBD, ulcerative colitis, they can also be symptoms. And then these are systemic conditions. So, what I'm asking is really interesting. Do you have any back pain? Do you cover your eyes? Do your eyes get red or painful? Something called uveitis, which is inflammation in your eye. So all of these things can occur. So it's important that we know that there's a condition called spinal arthritis, and the different parts that can affect it, even sometimes after the infection can cause this. So you have to talk to your doctor if you're having signs and symptoms of inflammatory back pain. Especially in light of this pandemic, a lot of patients are not getting any more consistent with their diet, of course, their gyms and their clothes. So a lot of these challenges are facing our patients, our community. But we have to stay the course and care about it. Don't go for that potato chips, don't go for that soda, drink a lot of water. Probiotics are good for your guys, maintain your diet, and if you go to the grocery store, just buy these things, right? A lot of patients say, I can't go to the gym, I can't get the right food. You can. You may not be able to go to the gym, but you can go for it. It's nice outside, go for a walk. Just don't go to the gym places, all right, guys? But exercise, stretch, there's tons of videos on YouTube. And we can also put some stuff out there for you guys to show you some kind of Thank you. assistant. Stay safe, keep your distance, wear your masks. Peace.
I'm Larry Micarenda. This has been the edition of Excelsior Forum and Profiles. We look forward to seeing you back here soon. Please keep safe. We'll see you soon.